We are going to start in Luke. We've been talking about the parables that deal with being ready and watching for his coming. And so we're going to start in the 12th chapter of Luke. We've got a couple parables that are back to back in this passage of scripture. So we're just going to hit them running. Starting at Luke, the 12th chapter and the 35th verse. It says, you know, we talked about, last time we talked about the five wise and the five unwise virgins, that five were ready and five were not when the bridegroom showed up because they had not purchased enough oil or they let their oil run out and they were not prepared. And when they went to buy more, the bridegroom had come and gone. And Jesus was likening that to... we know that he's coming. And something that I take out of that parable is it wasn't just five unsaved and five saved. But it did say, the scripture leads us to believe that Jesus was talking about those that had let their oil run out. And so that talks to me and tells me about those of us that must have had the joy of salvation at one time, and we have maybe gotten too commonplace, we've gotten too casual. We talked about that, about if you were here when I talked about as a kid, when kids are left home alone and they know what time their parents' return are, they start getting a little casual about letting down on what they are and are not supposed to be doing. I have a son that jumps in the shower about 2 minutes before we leave, no matter where we are going. Even though that we have been saying, we are leaving in an hour, we are leaving in 45 minutes, we are leaving in 30. This morning I heard, son, do not get in that shower 5 minutes before we leave. Yes, sir, I hear from upstairs, and he did not. He got in the shower 3 minutes before we left. And so we just get complacent. We get, we let down on what we know to be coming. We get lax. Let's all face it. We know that in our workplace, and I pride myself in being a person with good work ethic. I like to think of myself as one who gives 110%, whether the boss is watching or not, because I answer to a higher authority, a higher, insert whatever word you want here, a higher authority than my boss. However, I do know when my boss has been hunting in the woods for a week, it's very easy for me to go, I'm not going to go out on the campus when the bell rings. I'm just going to finish this here. I've got to get this done. You know, because I go out every time the bell rings, I'll go out on campus to make sure when the high schoolers are changing classes that, you know, we're behaving properly. But we do. When we know that our boss is not watching right over top of us, sometimes we get a little more laid back, even the best of us that have wonderful work ethics. We do. It's human nature. And, of course, human nature wars against things of the spirit. That's what Jesus was talking about in these parables, about talking about watching to be ready. The five unwise virgins, they knew that the bridegroom was coming. They had their oil. But the longer it took him, the more laid back they got, right? If you are like me and you know company is coming, and I am perfect. I have perfected the art of knowing how much time it will take to make the house from looking like a barnyard to a home and garden before company gets there. I've got it perfected. And then I will justify it by saying, there's no sense in cleaning it on Wednesday when they're coming on Friday, because by Thursday it'll have to be cleaned again. Right? So I know how to do that slide in. So I remember when Josie first started working up here at Walgreens. I mean, she was about 17, 18, and she knew, I'd say, Josie, you need to get in the car. It's time to get to work. It'd be like 10 till the time she was supposed to be there in Nebraska in 19. She'd be like, Mom, it's like 3 minutes and 47 seconds. And if you catch the County Road 1 light, it's like 4 minutes and 15 seconds. You know, I'm exaggerating, but I'm not exaggerating that she had it down to the minute, depending on which way she went and whether she got the green light or the red light at whatever intersection. And I would be going, Josie Creasy, that is not good work ethic. You need to get to work 10 minutes early. Da, 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 da. And the whole time in the back of my head, I'm thinking, oh, I got a house full for Thanksgiving. I should probably start getting the house clean. So we do. It's human nature. And so they were just, the longer they waited for the bridegroom. And so we have to make sure that as Christians, that we do not get so complacent that we forget his coming, or we think that his coming is still another 2,000 years out. It could be. It could be. It could be before we even finish this Sunday school lesson. And so we need to not be complacent in knowing that every second that we have that the Lord tarries is another second, an opportunity to share the gospel with those around us. Last night, Lori Farrell, those of you know her, Kayla's mom, she's been coming around lately for that past few months, and last night she got in there and she worked and she was throwing elbows and she just handled herself and she didn't stop and she was she was thinking through it. She wasn't just standing around waiting for somebody to tell her what to do. And we got done and we were cleaning up the mess and everybody starts scattering at mess time. You know, I know some people have legitimate reasons, but you know how it goes that when it comes time for the cleanup, the help tends to thin out. And she was right in there, buddy, doing it like very last minute. And as we get done, she said, I will definitely be doing this every time. And see, and up until last night, she could have been doing that. She just wasn't aware that it was available. That it was just, or there's a new awakening in her. And I remember that feeling, working with the homeless years ago before we even come to this church to pastor. And I remember that very first time I served dinner at that mission. And I remember thinking, I will be doing this forever. But now 20-something years later, even coming up on a feeding now, I'll be going, well, I don't know if I'm going to make this one. I've been just working all week. I'm exhausted. There'll be enough help there. Now, there's a time for respite, and we know that we need to rest in the Lord. We know that. But most of the time, the reason that I'm so exhausted is not because I've been doing a homeless feeding every night. It's because I've been running back and forth, taking care of all kinds of busy stuff. Usually because I waited till the last minute because I have it timed perfectly of how and when I have to get it done. So it's not that I'm so busy I'm too exhausted to do the Lord's work. It's just that I sometimes procrastinate and then slide it in at the last minute. I'll come in sliding in sideways and then I just go, I can't do another thing for the Lord because I'm just so exhausted. So it's planning. It's planning. And so waiting on the Lord, we need to make use of every bit of time that the Lord has given us. We say, remember the scripture, it said, even so, Lord, come quickly. We say that. Sometimes I'll get really tired and I'll just think, oh, I'll just be glad when the Lord comes back. Then I'll think, but wait, my sister needs to be saved. But wait, my so-and-so needs to be saved. But wait. And so if we looked at every bit of time that we still have waiting for the Lord as an opportunity.
Right.
To those of you that know Z-Man, I love it. Every time that he sees or witnesses or hears about somebody getting saved, he'll go, one more snatched from hell's grip. And it's just an excitement about and understanding, somebody got saved. Oh, great. Do we realize what that means? we get complacent, and it's just a simple statement. Oh, did you hear so-and-so's sister got saved? We do. Do we realize that that's a soul snatched from hell's grip?
Right.
Bud?
It seems like also that the more difficult it is for you to get to the thing that you're going to do for the Lord, like the homeless feeding and some ministries, the more of a blessing you catch from it. It's mm-hmm. like, okay, I'm going to give you this extra blessing because you took the extra effort to do this when you could have sidestepped this. And the example I always remember is in Hudson when we used to run the bus route. You know, it's all spread out, so it's difficult. It takes an hour to run the bus up there out in the woods and bombing range roads and stuff. And I come in from work in Tampa just in time to jump in the shower and jump in the bus Sunday morning and take off. Well, I was sick as a dog, so I actually had to take a 5-gallon bucket and set it beside me while I was driving. Mm-hmm. And one of the kids asked me, "What's that for, Mr. Fry?" I said, "You don't want to know."
Yeah.
But that was the day when I always took the kids to get a snack after we left the church, because there was a store next to the church. I'd pull over in the parking lot, then go in and get something for the ride home. The kids didn't have any money. I'd send Josh in with a few bucks to buy this kid something. Well, this one kid, there was 5 kids and a mother and a father that lived in a 32-foot gutted travel trailer. Mm-hmm. And we would have to sometimes go in and dress those kids and give them some snacks for breakfast because the parents would be passed out when we got there still. And long story, but that little, the oldest boy was, how old was he, Josh? About 7 or 8, 6?
I think so, about 6.
But we stopped at the store, and that little kid, and I got my sick pocket there, and I'm feeling sorry for myself because I'm nauseous. I'm like, oh man, I gotta get this over. A little kid comes up and taps me on the shoulder, and he's got a big bushy hair, and his clothes are half dirty. And he goes, "Mr. Fry, I'm going in to get something. Because would you like to share with me?" And this kid had a $1 food stamp, and he was going to share with Mr. Fry. Man, I lost it.
I'm
like,
sure.
Shut up, fool. I said, I got all teared up. I said, "No, it's okay, son. You go ahead and get it." And I always remember that. I would have missed that blessing had I given in to me being sick.
Yeah. You know, those of you that may have seen my Facebook post a couple days ago about the the young man that I get a card from him, and his mom has always been really good to bless the teachers and the office staff. And I had him in sixth grade. I taught him in sixth grade before I moved into the office, you know, 3 years ago. He's a senior this year. And he brings in this card, and it's actually got my name in his handwriting on it, which was odd because his mom has always made him sign his name, and then she's blessed everybody. And I open up the card, and out falls this $5 Starbucks card. And he has written just a personal message to me over in the left-hand side of the card in his own handwriting, and he's done some doodle work and some artwork and stuff that I had to about get him into a headlock to get him from doing in sixth grade instead of his math, you know. And he's done all this, done a fantastic job, and he drops it and leaves. And I get an email from his mother, and his mother said, "What I wanted to let you know was that the $5 Starbucks card," and this kid has a lot of challenges. He has a lot of challenges. So a job and a driver's license is a huge deal for him, okay? So he got him a job. He just sat down. He got his first paycheck a week ago. He sat down. His dad showed him how that they were going to do a budget and how he was going to put some, you know, toward car insurance. They won't even let him drive at this point. He's not even really ready to drive. He's got a driver's license, but he's going to put some toward his car insurance, and he's going to put a little bit here and a little bit there, and then he had a little bit left over, and he could do with what he wanted. And he said, I want to buy my own Christmas presents. And so that's what he had left to spread out between the people that he wanted to buy Christmas gifts for. And he didn't tell me that. His mom emailed me that and told me that. And you talk about melting me.
$5.
You talk about melting me, because $5 to him was huge, because that's the first money he'd ever earned at a real job in his life.
And
he could have gone and bought him some iTunes with it.
Right.
He loves music. He could have bought him a new air freshener or new something another for his new car that his mom and dad, his used car that his mom and dad had bought him. Because at 17, 18-year-old kid, that's what I'd have done with it.
Right, clothes.
Oh, yeah. You know, I'd have been at Play-Doh's getting me a new pair of shoes, you know. I was so extremely touched. I was so moved. So moved. That more so probably by the words that were in the card, but more so by the fact that he took what was his, that he earned, that he was proud of, and gave it to me. Mm. And just some woman that about had him in a headlock many, many times in sixth grade. Mm. And I shared that with you to tell you last night, we're at the homeless feeding. Years ago, those of you know that know who Barry Mason is, that founded the Heaven Saints Motorcycle Ministry, years ago in the late 70s and early 80s, he started these light clubs. And they were just basically a place, it was before, you know, Big Sisters, Big Brothers, and before the Youth Long Centers and the Latchkey programs. And he would open up clubhouses in inner city areas and with pool tables and arcade games and snacks and different things like this. And this would be a place for kids to come and hang out. So that they would not get, it was at first it was a gang prevention, so it would later be prison prevention. And it was just, these were kids that were being raised by the streets because their moms, if they weren't passed out somewhere, they were working two or three jobs because they were either one or the other. And so they were absent for whatever reason, because they were trying or because they were caught up in stuff that the enemy binds people with. And so it gave these kids a warm, safe place to hang out and to have a good time. And Z-Man had one here downtown Clearwater. And I don't know, remember when he closed it. I think I was pregnant with Shiloh when he actually closed it. So she's 17, so that was close to 18 years ago. And so we're down at the homeless feeding last night, and this guy walks across the street. This grown man walks across the street, and he looked at him and he said, "Z-Man?" And Z-Man looked at him and he said, "Yeah, that's me. And, you know, do I know you?" And he said, "Well, you did when I was a kid. When I was 9 years old, you had a little clubhouse over here that I used to hang out in, and you taught me how to play pool." Wow. The guy was 33 years old. So, what, 20, 21, 22 years ago, this kid hung out that light club, and Z-Man taught him how to play pool, and he was at his mother's house across the street from the homeless. He wasn't at the feeding. He was at a house in the neighborhood across the road from the feeding. And he looked out the door and saw Z-Man 20-something years later and recognized him as the man that taught him how to play pool when he was a kid running the streets.
Because awesome. He made a big impression on him. If he hadn't made that big impression, yeah.
He loved on him. He spent time with him.
Right.
He simply spent time with him. That's he didn't good. Take him. He didn't take him to Busch Gardens and buy him a ticket and ride roller coasters with him. Although that would be okay too.
Right.
He just simply opened his doors and said, "I'll hang out here and hang out with you guys that I don't even know."
Right.
I mean, when you're a kid and you don't have that, you'd give in that door.
Right, right. So, you know, we never know. The time is short. We never know when the Lord's coming back. And, you know, do you make a difference? Do you make a difference? Sometimes, Amy posted something yesterday on Facebook, and I had actually read it in an article that somebody had written about this whole Duck Dynasty thing and thing like that. And it said, and I don't even remember if I'm quoting it right, and it, but it said something about if you're mean when you say what you have to say, what you have to say won't mean anything. And it was talking about how we speak to people, how we address people, and how we, you know, just a simple smile at somebody, especially this time of year.
Right.
Especially this time of year. We have, I hope Melissa will forgive me for this. She's not in here, but she made a post on Facebook here a while back, so it's pretty public. But, you know, she just recently lost her mom. How long has she been gone? Mike, not a year? A year and a half, maybe? This is her first Christmas without her, right? Or second Christmas without her. And she said, it hurts this time of year because her mom, they always make cookies together, and her mom was always so giving toward people, and Christmas was huge to them, and her mom loved this time of year. And you know, so sometimes just walking by her going, you know, it doesn't even have to be anything sentimental. Hey, gorgeous, how are you doing today? You may uplift somebody's spirits that you know, somebody's spirit that's having a tough time. The way you conduct yourself is huge.
It's a tough time.
It's huge. You know, we think the gospel is being able to sit down and give it this big exegesis on what was meant when the children left the bondage of, you know, and that how that you need to come out. It's not. Sometimes it's just simply smiling, saying, hey, gorgeous, good morning. You know, hey, gorgeous, good morning.
I shared that Wednesday night that, you know, what really brought that home to me was the whole Jack Murphy thing, and how it was Roger Staubach, after 10 years of ministries, coming into the prison and witnessing to him. You know, and we always want to tell about the Jesus story and this and that. Roger Staubach said, if you wake up tomorrow and you're wearing orange, you need a new life coach.
Yeah.
And that was the gospel message for him, because that led into what Christ can do, and we all know the story after that. But, yeah, just the simplicity of a... having a good attitude, or why are you so happy, and sharing with them, and just the smallest things mm-hmm. can make have the biggest impact. It's amazing.
You know,
and sometimes we don't even know for years later.
Right. I'll tell you something. You all know Tatiana that comes here. Todd, redheaded Todd. You gotta know Todd. and she lights up a room. When I had her in sixth grade, probably the females will know what this is, the little snow babies that are collector's items. I don't know if you've ever seen them, like in the Hallmark stores. They're just these little kids that are dressed up in Eskimo suits, and they cute little things, like, but they're highly collectible, like the precious moments. Somebody had gotten me a set of three little snow babies that spelled out joy. One had a J, one had an O, and one had a Y, and he was kicking up his little leg to make the Y. And I treasured those things. I've had them for years. I don't even remember where I got them, but I treasured them there. And in sixth grade, my why disappears. And it just disappeared. And I gave the class this whole, if it shows back up, because, you know, I thought they were trying to be cute. They're sixth graders. They're middle schoolers, who most people cannot stand. I adore middle schoolers. I said, okay, if it shows back up, I will look the other way. We'll never have another discussion again, but it better show back up, right? And I was upset. I was upset. And then I was upset for myself. I shouldn't have put it out, an item that was so precious to me. I shouldn't have put it out in my classroom. And like 2 weeks went by. And I had already gotten, it was getting ready to, like we had the Christmas break. We come back from break. A couple days into break, I'm getting ready to start putting the Christmas stuff back up in my classroom. And I go to get those three little snow babies, and there's the Y back in place with his little leg glued back on. Aww. And Tatiana came to me later, and she said, Mrs. Creasy, I was sharpening my pencil, and I knocked him over, and it broke. And I knew how precious they were to you, so I just took it home and glued it, and it took me a really long time to get it back to you because I didn't have any super glue. That little set of snow babies is more precious to me now than it ever was before. Because a lot of kids nowadays would have just stuck that right back up there, would not have said a word, and would have gone back to their seat. But she knew it was precious to me. So she set about to fix her mistake. She owned up to her mistake, and then she did what she could to fix it. So now I have that little, and so every time I look at that little set of snow babies now, I know I don't even associate that with a little collectible item that somebody used to give me one time. Now I look at that with that little Y with this little broken on, glued on leg as a gift of love from a kid that loved me just for a minute. And so it's those little things that mean a lot. I have a thing pinned up on my wall in my office behind my desk in second grade handwriting. All loopy, everything's misspelled. And it says, Mrs. Creasy, I'm sorry about your hourglass. Oh, you are. I will get you a new one. And there's a couple other misspelled words in it. Love, Emily. And here's what happened. Little Emily didn't have anything for show and tell that day. So she come into the office all upset. And I said, well, come back in here in my office and see if you can find something that you can take to show and tell. And I had the hourglass that we had bought for Jaden's birthday party because we did the Alice in Wonderland thing. And I had it on my book on my bookcase. I just love it. And it's a neat hourglass with real pretty sand in it.
Do you still have it?
Not anymore. I'm getting ready to finish the story. And
I wonder where that went.
Well, now it's swept up in the dumpster from a year ago. But anyway, she said, oh, can I take that? And immediately I thought, ooh, Shelby said to save that for her. It's from my granddaughter's second birthday party. It's kind of special to me. I love it. It's glass. And I looked at her, and her little eyes were like this big. And I said, sure, baby, you go ahead. Because her happiness in that moment was more special to me. It meant more to me than any tangible item that I could have sitting on a shelf. Well, here she come back 15 minutes later. I'm so sorry. I dropped it. I'm so sorry I dropped it. I loved on her, told her it was no big deal, not to worry about it, and she hands me this note. And that's what the note said. That note, her mom came in and said, we'll get you a new one. Her mom works at school, we'll get you a new one. I said, don't even worry about it. This note is more precious to me than the hourglass was because it shows somebody thinking about my feelings. Somebody showing, that was over a year ago. I opened up a Christmas present from little third grade Emily this year, and it was an hourglass. She still remembered. Okay. So while we're waiting for the Lord, we need to not lose sight of the fact that people matter. In their brokenness, they matter. In their messes, they matter. They matter. And the more time that the Lord has given us, He's not given us so that we can lay at home flipping through the channels, trying to slide in sideways, wondering when our parents are going to come home. You know, he is coming back, and we need to be watching, and we need to be ready. But while, you know, it reminds me of when he ascended in the first place. He, remember what the disciples were told? Because the disciples watched him go up, right? And they're all standing there still watching. And what were they told?
Why?
What did the angel say? Why do you stand here gazing? Basically, get busy. Because if you remember, Jesus had already told them, I must go away. It's beneficial to you. I have to go away. But I go away so that another will come, and he will give you power to be witnesses unto the whole world. So in other words, all right, we've just brought some closure to my ministry on earth. Now I'm handing you the baton because I have to go away. I'm no longer going to be able to minister here like this. I go so that another can come to minister. The Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost. He's going to come and minister, and he is going to make you ministers by endowing you with power from on high. So I've got to go away so that you can do that. And so then when he ascended, he already told his disciples that. So when he ascended and the disciples are still there, looking at him because he had said he'd come back, and now he's gone, he's disappeared. They're rubbernecking at this point to see what they could see. And the angel says to them, what? Why stand you here gazing?
Coming back.
He's coming back. In other words, chop chop. Get busy. Get busy. On open house night at the school, we go back 2 weeks ahead of the students. A week and a half in is the open house. They have that week and a half to get their bulletin boards up, to get their room spiffy, to make the room presentable to parents. And so, guess what? I'm constantly going around going, Thursday night, parents are coming. Let's go. Let's go. Thursday night, parents are coming. Get busy. Let's go. Let's go. I've walked in a couple rooms on Wednesday when they've been there a week and a half, and I'm going, what have you been doing all this time? where's your bulletin boards? What, you know? And so this is the parables of the waiting for him. That because he's coming back, or to be busy, well, to be busy, be prepared, be ready, coming back. I remember one time Scott called me, and this was back before I was working. I was still at home, and he called, and I don't even remember what the event was. I don't know if it was a work party or a something, but he called and he said, I'm going to come in, I'm going to jump in the shower, I'm going to get dressed, and we're going to be in the car and go. Be ready. Okay? And I was caught up in something. I don't know, Lifetime movie or something. I don't remember. And back before they had DVR, you know, and I thought, ooh, I can, ooh, and I watched the clock because I knew what time he'd pull in the driveway, right? And I'm thinking, yeah, I can do a shower and get ready in 45 minutes. Yeah, I can do a shower and get ready in 30 minutes. Well, if I had to, I could get ready in 20 minutes. And I got caught up, and I remember hearing his car pull in the driveway. And then I fly out of the shower and jump in like I've been there the whole time. You know, and so, sadly, I think sometimes we look at our Christian walk that way. The Lord showed us, there's work to do. Get it done. Because I'm getting ready to pull into the driveway, and we need to be ready to go.
Did you get raptured, or did he leave you behind?
I'm not sure. I don't remember. This was years ago. I don't remember.
That's what we're all wondering.
That was a good one.
So,
left behind.
So, I might have, it may have been a two-car night. I'm not sure. But that's what we do. That's what we do. And Jesus is saying, I'm getting ready to pull in the driveway. I'm going to pick you up, and then we're going. So get everything done that you need to get done now. Luke 12, starting in the 35th verse. Let your loins be girded about and your lights burning. In other words, your loins be girded about. Be dressed. Be ready to go. Right? Shelby, you never know when you're going to get a flat tire in your pajamas. Right? So, you know, happened to me one time. Running a kid to school that I was babysitting. I kept him before and after school. I dropped him off at school and picked him up at school. I'm in pajama pants and a t-shirt because I'm not getting out of the car. I run him to school, drop him off, pull out of the parking lot of the school, boom, get hit by a car in my pajamas. I'm standing outside the car in my pajama pants. It happens. I got caught in my pajamas, unprepared for the day. I'm ready for the day. Verse 36. And ye yourselves like unto men that wait for their Lord, when he will return from the wedding, that when he cometh and knocketh, they may open unto him immediately. Blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. Verily I say unto you that he shall gird himself and make them to sit down to meat, and he will come forth and serve them. And if he shall come in the second watch, or come in the third watch, and find them so, blessed are those servants. And this know, that if the good man of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched, and not have suffered his house to be broken through. And that's true, right? If I said to you, I'm going to come break into your house about 2 o'clock this morning. And I'm going to take that new Mac computer. I'm going to take that new flat screen TV. I'm going to take that new whatever you got. Really? You're going to go to bed? No, you're going to be sitting up in the living room waiting for me to come through your front door. Right? So why is it that when the Lord said to us he's coming back, that we get so complacent, that we forget to watch, that we forget, I get tickled because Scott always says, I'm not going to die. I'm just going to wait for the Lord to come back. You know, we do, right? Because I just this morning said, Josie, I had some alabaster boxes that I had given away in my ladies' fellowship. And I had a couple left over, so I asked my daughters to pick one out. And Josie had picked one that when I had ordered them all, I actually ordered one specifically to keep that I had liked. And that's the one Josie picked. And I'm like, oh, that's the one I wanted, right? And then I said to Scott this morning, I said, well, might as well give it to her now when she wants it instead of saving it for her when I die. So we have, you know, we have this view of, you know, I'm just going to die before Christ comes back. And that could be true. It could be, you know, 2,000 years. But he could come back before the 11 o'clock service today. You know, and so, but we think in that mentality. We think when my life is over, I better work and put away a retirement fund for my, I better leave an inheritance to my children. This is our mindset. Our mindset is not, he could split the eastern sky any day. You know. And this know that if the goodman of the house had known when I was the thief would come, he would have watched and not have suffered his house to be broken through. Be ye therefore ready also, for the Son of Man cometh at an hour when ye think not.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Another parable, verse 41. Then Peter said unto him, Lord, speakest this parable unto us, or even to all? Because remember, I told you Jesus would teach to specific audiences. That didn't mean that his teaching was limited to that audience. That meant that he used things that audience would understand so that he would get the illustration across. Then Peter said unto him, Lord, speakest thou this parable unto us or to everybody? Again, I love it. Always somebody, Peter, every time he opens his mouth, because he wasn't even thinking at that point, okay, are you talking to me? Are you going to let everybody know this? You know, we think in our limb. It just gives us a view into very limited understanding. This morning, Shiloh and Scott and I were having a conversation, Zeb, on the way to church, and we were talking about different manifestations of the Holy Ghost and how different people are blessed in different ways. And I said, that's the great thing about God. He's not limited to our understanding. I remember having a conversation with your sister one time when she may have just started coming here. And we were talking about speaking in tongues and different manifestations of the Holy Ghost. And what she said to me, she said, well, I never have, but... And she had kind of a Baptist upbringing, which sometimes some Baptist sects will say it's just of the devil. Some, not all do. But she said, but I never had that thinking because we're going to say God, the devil can do something that God can't. I never want to limit God in what he can do. So I will believe anything that God is doing through his people.
Amen.
You know, and it was later because... Then later, she got a really good blessing by the Holy Ghost, which was a whole funny story in itself. But I love that mentality. I love, because that shows a heart toward God. And that is, God can do whatever he wants to do.
Amen.
He's not limited to our understanding or our understanding of theology or our interpretation of the Bible. God doesn't need you understanding what he does in order to perform it. And we need to remember that. I need to remember that. Sometimes I have a very self-righteous view of who is deserving of God's blessings and who's not, and he has to check me sometimes.
Right. Sister Shelley, I also think we keep ourselves in the Old Testament or the Bible in such a way that these examples aren't for us. So bringing forward examples, real-world examples today, like that testimony of that guy, that forgiveness testimony, that people can relate to,
right.
Oh, he was wronged, he forgave,
mm-hmm.
or a blessing that you've given to somebody or somebody has blessed you with, and really making it real right now, today, that it is, you know, that he wants us. That's
right.
That's what he wants.
We do. We tend to have a view of this being a storybook.
Right.
And we believe it. It's true stories.
Right.
This is just a historical document of true stories.
Right.
And what I always say to people, they'll say, well, that was back during the apostolic age. We're still in the apostolic age. That was back in the Bible days. My answer to that is Genesis has passed. Revelation has not yet passed. We are still living in the Bible days.
Right.
Let's remember the one scripture where Jesus said, all these you will do greater.
Right, right.
Everything in this book. Everything in this book.
Right.
Has been done, but you will do greater.
Mm-hmm.
So this isn't just a historical document of what has happened. This is a, hey, FYI, this is what needs to be happening. A manual, if you will.
Right.
And the Lord said, who then is that faithful and wise steward whom his Lord shall make ruler over his household to give them their portion of meat in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. Of a truth I say unto you, that he will make him ruler over all that he hath. We do this. We do this. Do we not?
Mm-hmm.
When somebody has proven themselves to me, I will use them time and time again for a project. Or I know who I can trust. Okay, I know who I can trust. Yesterday, at the homeless feeding, I saw a gentleman that was with one of the groups. He wasn't one of the homeless men. He was with one of the churches. But he was probably about 10 to 15 years senior to my 17-year-old daughter. And I saw him having her beside a truck, talking to her. And I looked at Ken. I was behind the line. I was busy looking. I looked at Ken Williams. I said, see the silver truck? He said, and I saw it catch his eye too. Before I even said anything to him, I said, keep an eye on that, would you? He started heading that way. Okay? I didn't even have to tell him anything because I knew I could trust him to keep an eye on my kid. Okay? And the funny thing was, is that Jasmine walked up about that time and said, hey, Shiloh, will you come here for a minute? And Ken said, Jasmine's on it. It was just kind of funny. You know, but the thing was, I knew that there were men amongst us that I could trust to watch out for my daughter amongst a group of men. Okay? There is a lady at work that if I say to her, listen, for spring formal this year, I want a huge spaceship. I have no idea what you're going to make it out of, but there's some cardboard and some tool in the back. I don't give it another thought. Because I know when I come in to decorate for spring formal, there's going to be the coolest spaceship that I've ever seen right there dead center in that room. Because she's proven herself to me over and over and over. So when we know that. We know that in our natural lives. I know at my house which kid I can ask to do the dishes, and which kid I can ask to take out the trash, or which kid I can ask to do this, because I know which one will do the better job at it. You know, we actually, our pastor actually come under some scrutiny by somebody one time, scrutiny is probably not the right word. He kind of got lambasted by somebody one time because they wanted, now they've been around for a month or two. Now they've been on the outskirts. We know this person and have for years, but they started coming around solid at church for a couple months. They said to Scott, I want to start teaching adult Bible study. And Scott said, well, I'm glad you want to work. I'm glad you want to pitch in. I'm glad you want to get started. Right now, we have an opening in children's church. They really, really need some help in children's church. I'd like to see you get dug in, get plugged in. Start where you can start filling in a time here and there. That's where the greatest need is. Start teaching. Now, if he hadn't have trusted her to teach, he sure wouldn't have put her with the children. He'd have put her with the adults before the children if he didn't have trusted her to teach, above all people. But having a little bit of wisdom and knowing how people are and being able to be given a little bit of time and responsibility, that insulted this person. This insulted this person. And he got lambasted to the point where he took a cussing because they wanted to teach adult figure. Yeah.
There you go.
Okay, there you go. And I remember saying to him later, it's a wonder that, you know, the wisdom the Lord gives us. Because when the Lord gives us something to watch over, we have to be careful with that. But what he was saying to us is, that he has entrusted us, and we're going to stop here because we just got like 2 minutes left. He has entrusted us with the earth and the people therein. He's trusted us with them.
Amen.
He's trusted us with them. And if he can trust us with those, he'll give us more. He'll give us more. So, you know, we might want to look at a little, take a little inward glance. If If we can't ever get anybody to come to church, if we can't ever tell anybody about the gospel of the Lord, it might be because we're not showing them anything different about this Lord we talk about. I remember years ago when we first started pastoring, and we were I don't even know if conservative is the word, because I deem myself to be conservative now, but I would say that we were probably more self-righteous in that we were clothesline Christians, and I had never grown up in the church. He had grown up in a very conservative Pentecostal church that was very, they would, at one time the women didn't wear pants, they didn't wear makeup, they didn't cut their hair, I think you're familiar, aren't you, Becky? You're familiar with that type, and that very straight-laced, staunch, prim, and proper, and that was your clothesline religion, that you were set apart to be holy if you wore denim skirts, and that's what we came, you know, and we got saved, and we come into the church, and we tried to pastor that way. We tried to pastor that way, we had a set of rules right here, the 29 teachings. Ooh, Brother Jay knows about those. He was raised on those. The 29 teachings. You didn't go swimming, that was mixed bathing. You didn't, okay? Oh, Josh knows about those too.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay. So, all right. And we remember the church was, the church was dead. The church was dead. People weren't coming. And I remember just praying and praying and praying and seeking the Lord and seeking the Lord for why were there not any people coming? And the Lord said, when I can trust you with the ones you have, I'll send you more. When I can trust you with the ones you have. And you talk about cracking us wide open. The Lord started teaching us how to minister instead of how to run a church. You know, so we are out of time. If you guys would shake somebody's hand, tell them good morning.